So, I want to introduce you to my audience because we've known each other a long time. And you've had a really cool journey. We've both done similar things along the way at points, haven't we? You've done a lot of fitness stuff. You've had a gym. You've been a power lifter. You've done like a bodybuilding physique competition. You've done all kinds of entrepreneurial, online marketing stuff. You're like this mum fitness guru. So I just wanted to give people a heads up of the kind of thing we're going to be talking about in this conversation. But how are you today?
I'm really good, thank you. Looking forward to talking to you. I like it when, you don't really know what's coming, because, when I do podcasts with interviews and stuff with people, they want a list of questions. It's quite nice just to be able to just talk.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. It's really nice just to let it flow. I never really plan. I mean, it's nice to have just a couple of bullet points about like roughly what we're going to talk about. But yeah, I agree. It's nice if it just flows, isn't it?
Yeah, natural.
And also with this podcast, I don't really have any outcome or any agenda. I'm not promoting anything. I don't particularly care. It's like it's nice to have that freedom, isn't it? What I was going to say is, oh, I had a few things on my mind. Oh, yeah, I wanted to tell people that are listening. We met at a Tony Robbins seminar.
Yeah, we did a long time ago. You remember the date, though, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I do remember. It was 2006, and it was Date with Destiny. Why don't you tell your memory of that, and I'll see if it matches mine.
Okay, so I'm really bad at dates and stuff, and I have quite a bad memory. But so it was that Date with Destiny, and we never met at Elisa Power within UPW, did we?
No, so when
No.
what got you involved in the Tony Robbins thing in the first place?
My dad actually. My dad decided. I don't know. We just kind of heard about this guy. No, I it was actually me. I used to work in a bank, and I had a management level position. And so with that, you had access to all sorts of resources. They were quite good, actually. In fact, they were a great bank to work for, and they were always pushing you to be learning about yourself, understanding marketing, self-development. And I actually came across a book called Who Moved My Cheese, and then one of Tony Robbins' books. So then I started Googling him and finding a little bit more about him, and I mentioned it to my dad, and he said, we should all go on this. So we all went to UPW as a family, me and my mum, my brother, and myself. And at the time, we were all quite sickly. Like, I was always ill, always had one thing after the other. My dad had arthritis and he had to be on medication, which he hated. My brother was obese, literally obese, overweight. Like,
Your
you know what he
brother.
looks like. Yeah, he was so big. I know people don't want to, if they don't know his backstory, they have no clue
I didn't
how
know
big he
that.
used to be.
Hang,
Yeah.
one second. Let me just stop you. There's a little bit of like a rattling sound. Are you on your headphones? Are you?
Yeah, I think it might be my hair.
Oh, is it? Yeah. Just try taking the headphones out and putting the phone to the ear. Just see if that's any better.
That better?
Yeah, I think that'll be better. Yeah, it was a
Okay.
little bit rustling. Okay, cool. Right, just for our listeners, your brother basically looks like the Rock. He's jacked. He's like jacked, isn't he? So I had no idea he was overweight. So tell us about that.
Yeah, so he was always big from a child, always. In fact, he had he's we're all quite flat footed. That's just something that runs in our family, and his was really, really bad because he was overweight. He had problems walking because his ankles were swollen all the time. His legs used to rub together, so he always had sores between his legs. And he was one of those children that he was always very happy, very friendly. So his weight never got in his way in terms of making friends and being sociable and stuff, but he was never particularly happy. And my dad never liked that he was overweight and wanted him to be fitter and healthier. And the other reason, he was into sports and rugby and everything else. He just wanted to look after his health and stop his issues with his ankles and all that kind of stuff. And so that's initially why we went to UPW. It's because we learned that on the last day they did something about health. And obviously, to get into the right mindset of it all and everything else. So we went to that, and that was, as you know, 3 days, and it was amazing. We loved it. And then out of all of us, it was only me that actually booked on to more courses. So I booked on with Date with Destiny. And you know how it is when you get in the hype and you put your hand up and you want to buy everything in the world, even though you can't afford it. And I just bought it. And I think I bought two other courses as well at the same time. And that was in Palm Springs, wasn't it? Date with Destiny.
Yeah, so yeah, that's where, and then I basically did the same thing. I went with my family as well, so pretty similar in London, and then yeah, I went to, and that's where we met, in Palm Springs, California, Date with Destiny. So a lot of people, because now that Tony Robbins got that documentary on Netflix, I
I've
think.
not watched it.
Oh, have you not? Okay, yeah.
Oh no, I'm gonna have to watch.
I know, because you had a bit of a bad experience as well, didn't you? I mean, I don't know if you want to get into that, but I think he's more of a household name now because of that Netflix documentary.
Okay.
And so I think, like, a lot of just normal people that you talk to, might not have heard of him before, but I noticed that people, a lot of people have know who he is now because of that, I think.
Yeah, well, I think he was doing all right for himself back then as well. But yeah, no, I don't have a bad word to say. It's not particularly him as such. I mean, I had a great experience. I loved the courses and met some great people. I think it was more so not him, but his sales team that are a little bit questionable at times.
That's okay. We don't need to get into that, because
No.
it's only sort of minor stuff in terms of the bigger story. Okay, so you're from going to UPW, your brother gets in shape.
So it was a long, people see him now and think that he's always looked that way and he doesn't really understand. But actually, since the age of 13, he's been working on his body. So from that day, it was literally immediate. We all said, we're not going to eat meat anymore. We're going to cut out dairy. We just did it. We became vegans overnight. And we stayed that way for a couple of years. Zach absolutely hated it because I'm not particularly a foodie, but he is. He loves his food. He loved tomato ketchup. That went on every meal. And so for him, it was like a big change. And it's almost like he didn't really get a choice because it was just done as a family, which is easier as well because you've got everyone else is doing it at the same time. And everybody liked the changes that they saw in the body. I wasn't as ill as often, and my dad doesn't need a medication for his arthritis. My mum's IBS just went away, and my brother started losing weight. And he's been losing weight since, until probably like the last 6 or 7 years, where he's really shaped his body into what it is now, and he eats a phenomenal amount, and he's obviously trained 4 hours a day. And so it wasn't a quick process. It wasn't an overnight thing. It was a long process for all of us, really.
And also you and your brother ended up starting a gym together, right?
Yeah, so I used to live in London and I moved back, and I was always into fitness anyway. Before that, I was dancing when I was in London. And he ran some kettlebell classes in different locations in Leicester, and it was him and one other guy. And they're two guys and they're quite built, and they kind of wanted a female to. I'd probably say that some of the females were quite intimidated to ask them for help because some women are. And so I said, oh, I'll do my PT qualification and then I'll come and teach classes or help. And that's basically how we started. And the classes became so popular that we couldn't find venues big enough because we had classes about 40, 50 people. And we couldn't, sometimes when you're hiring venues at different places, they're not always free when you want them, or you kind of like, if they cancel because of something they need to do, it affects your business. So we decided we were going to open a gym, which again was not an easy process. It took us about almost 2 years to get planning permission, which was disheartening, but we got there in the end. So yeah, we opened a gym together, and then we had another partner. So it was four of us in total, and we were a double award-winning gym first and second year. So yeah, it was a long journey, but it was definitely worth it.
Is it a specifically a CrossFit gym or not?
It wasn't originally. It was just a regular gym, but we were known for kettlebell classes. Zach was known for power, for CrossFit. I was known for powerlifting, and our other business partner was an ultra marathon runner. So we kind of attracted three different types of people: women that wanted to lift weights and wanted to break through that mold of being scared to lift heavy, men that wanted to do CrossFit, and women that wanted to do CrossFit, and people that wanted to do marathons. So we kind of had an unusual type of people in the gym. What we didn't really attract was bodybuilders.
Just for the listeners, tell us the name of the gym and the location in case they want to look it up.
So it was BeFitter Gym, and it's in Leicester, and it was in an area called Thurmaston, which it still is, but now it's called CrossFit BFG, and now it is purely just a CrossFit box that my brother runs with another CrossFit partner.
Okay, cool. At what point along the line you decided to compete in powerlifting? So how did that come about?
When I first started doing classes with my brother, I remember seeing the guys lift a 16 kilo kettlebell, which was it was yellow coloured, and none of the all the females were on eight, and so they didn't want to progress. They only wanted to be on an eight. And I remember saying to Zach, "Do you think I'd be able to lift a 16?" He went, "Oh, well, men tend to use them. They find them quite difficult." And when someone says something that to me, I almost want to prove them wrong. So I started secretly working towards it. And then he just said to me, "You know, you're quite strong. You should probably do something with that." And he put me in touch with a trainer that used to train him. His name's Tony Ward, not far from where we lived, who's specialised in bodybuilding and powerlifting. So he sent me to him to go and see what I could do. I'd never done a proper deadlift or squat or bench or anything like that, because I was always doing kettlebell classes and functional stuff. And he was like, "You know, you've got a good base. You should work on it." So I just started training with him and then started entering competitions. It just went from there.
How much did you end up lifting?
My max lift deadlift was 135 kilos, and I was in the 56 kilo category. That's my body weight. 55 kilo category weight class. My deadlift was 135. My bench was pretty awful. That was 50. And squat was 110.
Yeah, cool. And like, would you do it again, powerlifting, or do you feel like you're done with that?
I think I did the British and won that. I did the Europeans and won that. And I came third at the World. And I was kind of satisfied with that, because I ended up injuring my back, and it was not long before I was getting married, and my goal became not wanting to lift heavy weights, but actually just wearing heels on my wedding day. And then it kind of hit home how important it is to look after your body. And I think if powerlifting was recognised as an Olympic sport and women were catered for a bit more within it, I would be more tempted, but there's not much in it apart from injuries.
Yeah, I see. Yeah, we've talked about that, haven't we? It's very... You can push your body, and you want to push it more and more and more, because you want to lift heavier and heavier and heavier, and eventually something goes, doesn't it?
And you get trapped in wanting to keep up, and especially if you've had a bit of time out. When I had time out with an injury, and then you see people lifting what you were lifting as your max, you're like, "Oh, I've got to get stronger, I've got to get stronger," and you're like, "But why?"
Hey, I noticed something. I don't know if this has been the same experience for you, but I've seen other female people, friends in my life, that when they got into weightlifting, it completely transforms your self-confidence. Like, there's something about strength training and pushing your body in that anaerobic, intense kind of way that really makes you feel powerful and centered and grounded and kind of unstoppable. I'm sure, you know, how does that, with your experience...
I think what it does is, I think for a lot of women, they focus a lot on their bodies and wanting to change the shape of the body and wanting to improve their bum and lose weight and all this kind of thing. But I think when you get into weightlifting, that all is so irrelevant. And all you focused on is trying to be better than you were last time, trying to improve how much you can lift, and liking the feeling that you get when you do lift heavy. And that does transform your body at the same time. So I think you shift from being focused on how you look and instead on how you can perform, and that makes such a big difference on people's confidence.
I agree. I think I'm not gonna spend this podcast slagging off yoga, right? But
no, go on.
There is some people I really feel that instead of doing like gentle relaxation, yoga, meditation, because a lot of people do that hoping it will make them feel better, maybe to get rid of their anxiety or to, you know, improve the way they feel in some way. And I really think if they went and tried some intense like weightlifting, powerlifting, or maybe even martial arts or boxing or something like at the other end of the spectrum, I think it can have a wonderful effect on your well-being, your self-confidence, your state of mind, all those things.
Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, I've tried yoga a couple of times. I don't dislike it. I just find it doesn't really fit with me. I can do it. I can enjoy it, but I just get so much more from lifting weights and pushing my body in a different way.
Yeah, same here. You know, I'm not saying people shouldn't do the yoga meditation stuff. You know, if that's what they need, that's what they need, fine. If that's what they enjoy, fine. But some people, I really want to say to them, just go and try powerlifting, for Christ's sake. You know, I mean, you might find that it adds, that it really, you know, makes you feel good. So I'll leave it at that. I won't, because it's very easy for me to descend into moaning about yoga. Now, somewhere along the line, you decided to compete in physique. So, what at what point did you decide to do that?
It was after I injured my back through deadlifts that I still wanted to. I'm someone that I can train, but I like to train towards something. I like to have a goal. So, what I could do was bodybuilding because for the class that I wanted to do, which was bikini, I don't need a lot of muscle. So, it doesn't mean to say I have to lift really heavy. I could still lift average weights, but do more reps and get the kind of physique that I'd need to compete in that without having to strain my back or anything else. So it was something I could do whilst in recovery, if you like. It wasn't that bad, but that's we can call it that. And so and that's how I got into it. And I think actually my shape is more, I'm more natural for that than I was powerlifting. It's just I enjoyed powerlifting. I didn't actually think I'd enjoy bodybuilding, which is one of the reasons I wanted to do it, to see if I could do the prep and the strict diet and everything else that comes with it. But actually, I really, really, really enjoyed it. And it was only because after that I got married and then had Imani that I didn't compete again. But I am actually competing in January, not January, March.
Yeah, awesome. Even though me and you know the difference, just in case some of our listeners could just summarize, what's the difference from powerlifting and bodybuilding for people that don't know?
So powerlifting is three lifts and you have to try and lift as heavy as you can. So on a competition day, you get three attempts to do your max squat, max bench, and max deadlift. Bodybuilding is where you sculpt your body for a certain look and you're judged on that look. So it could be your how your hair looks, your makeup, in the category that I was in, this your skin tone, cellulite as well. Physique, you don't want to be too muscular, but you want to be lean, but you don't want to be too lean or too hard. They try and go for a look where you would look good in a bikini on a beach, but natural. So that's more subjective. A powerlifting is very much what you can actually physically do, and you know, you're not really judged on it apart from how well your lifts went.
Yeah, powerlifting is how much you can lift, and then bodybuilding is what you look like, basically. And
Yeah.
Also somewhere along, well, you were going to seminars and stuff, the same as I was, because you've been interested in like entrepreneurship and that kind of thing. And what's been your experience of the seminar circuit, over the years?
That's quite a good question. I think it's what you take from it because, you know, for a little while I worked with a company that did seminars as well. So you get to see a little bit of a different side of it. It's almost like you get to see too much behind the scenes and it makes you quite skeptical because I know that people that were running various different seminars were teaching about how to do something that they hadn't actually done themselves. And you know that, and you're like, that's. But people buy into it because they trust that person or they get in the hype of it at the seminar. And then you see the type of people that are coming through the doors. And sometimes you'll get, especially if it's a free seminar, you'll get the same people coming along like two or three times. And we used to call them biscuit munchers because they'd come and get the free biscuits, they'd have a cup of tea, they'd listen to the seminar, and then they'd go home. And then you see them again a couple of months later. I think it depends on the type of seminar because you obviously get different types of people at different types of events. Like Tony Robbins is so varied. But I think it's a I think you have to be very careful not to become a seminar junkie and actually stop and put into practice what you've learnt. So what I do personally is if I've subscribed to something and I've bought an online course or something, I don't even open another email from that person or anything else until I've finished doing the course. It's so easy to get distracted by the next thing.
Yeah, I have a very similar point of view on all that. You do have to be careful because whatever seminar you go to, they will always make you feel like if you buy their course for like £1,000 or £2,000, or then your life is going to be transformed. You're going to be rich. All your problems are going to they'll always make you feel like that, and you have to be careful because. I had a similar experience. I was behind the scenes a little bit with some stuff, and I went to some conferences with some of the speakers, a lot. It can be pretty slimy, hearing the conversations backstage. All they cared about is the sales, how much money they'd made. It was very like that's all they cared about.
Yeah, not customer focused.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, you do have to be careful because people will take your money. And it is hard to distinguish, isn't it? Because there is good value in it and there is genuine information and they can genuinely help. But discerning is very hard to discern what's a good decision to invest and what in, isn't it?
I know. I think it's even harder now because there's just so much stuff. So when we were going to seminars and stuff, you were going to a physical seminars, but now there's webinars, and so you can just sign up to six just from being on Facebook on lots of different topics, and they'll all have a product that you need to unlock whatever potential they're telling you to unlock, and then you get that. And then what's disappointing is I find it disappointing that people don't recognize the pattern, but you get the next one, and then you find that there's almost everything you need to learn, apart from that one thing that's in the next course that you'd have to buy. And it just keeps going on and on and on. And then you think, are you trying to help me or just trying to take my money?
Yes, it can be very manipulative, can't it? And you can end up feeling very kind of used and stuff. Yeah, that is the dark side of all this, isn't it, unfortunately? And
Yeah, and I feel sorry for the people that are genuinely trying to make a difference because they can almost be like tarred with the same brush. You know, if you see
yeah.
something about a free webinar, you're like, yeah, but is it really free and what do you want to sell? But actually, it might just be a free webinar.
Yeah, right. Yeah. By the way, I do have a course for sale. No, just joking. it's only 3,999. But if you buy today, it's only anyway. That's kind of how it goes, isn't it? What was I just thinking? I was just thinking to myself. I've had a couple of experiences like. It's interesting. I had an experience with this kind of ebook, and I won't say what it was because I don't want to kind of embarrass anyone. But I was this person sent it to me for free, and it was their main product. And I was like, oh, that's very nice of you, thank you. I was looking forward to, I was really anticipating that the information in it was going to be, really powerful. And I got it, and it was just so basic and so I was so underwhelming. All the information in it was really obvious, and there wasn't much information. And I thought to myself, and then I had another experience where I paid a marketing company to manage my online AdWords stuff, and that was a similar underwhelming. Like they produced worse results than I was getting on my own. And I don't know what I'm trying to say. I'm not quite sure what point I'm making, but I think what I'm trying to say is just because people will make all kinds of promises, and you have to be careful. I think that's just really what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, and I have found, I think there's actually a market for, say, for someone like you and I who've read and consumed a lot of information. Like, if you get a regular free download, you're probably going to know all that stuff in there. But I do find there's a lack of. If I want information on, I don't know, say YouTube marketing, and I get a free ebook, that stuff it's so basic. There needs to be like a level where you actually deliver some kind of content for people that are not starting from level one. Do you know what I mean? But I feel like so much stuff is catered from level one, and that's it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean. Let's because right, so somewhere along the line you have your daughter and you start your new sort of business brand, and so tell us about that.
Well, initially it started off just as a blog whilst I was pregnant, and I blogged about my pregnancy, experiences, and training that I was doing through it, because I was getting a lot of questions about that. And it was before I went on maternity leave, and then when I did go on maternity leave, for someone that's pretty active all the time, I just thought, you know, people are going to want to know what I do fitness-wise afterwards too. So I started putting together a few programs that I was genuinely going to do at home. And then I made those programs available so other people could do them if they wanted to do. And it kind of just, it wasn't an intentional business. It kind of just spiraled. And I actually really enjoyed doing it. And things changed with the gym. I couldn't go back to working 16-hour shifts. Even though I love doing all those hours, it's not the same when you become a full-time parent. I want to be a full-time parent. I wanted to change things so that I could do what I enjoy doing, which is training people, helping people get results, but do it so I could tailor it around Amani's needs, and that's basically what happened, and it all worked out quite perfectly.
So what do you offer in terms of you do coaching and you've got like online courses? Like, what is it exactly? And tell people the name of it as well.
Yeah, so it's Mum Warrior, and you can find all the information on mumwarrior.com. But basically, I started when I first had Imani. For someone with a fitness background, I still found it very difficult to find time to fit in a workout or do any kind of exercise. And Imani, who's my daughter, she's never slept well at all since a newborn. So her naps would be, it could be just 10 minutes. And I just think, okay, I need to do 10 minutes or something. And so at the beginning, I'd just do squats because they help with your pelvic floor. They get you going. You can turn it into a bit of a cardio workout if you do them fast enough. They're quiet. You don't make a lot of noise. Don't need any equipment. I could do it while she was sleeping. I could do it whilst I was holding her. I could do it whilst I was making something to eat. So I started with that. And then I put out a squat challenge for people to do if they wanted to do it. And then people were asking about the biggest question I get asked a lot is how do you get rid of your mum tum or jelly bellies, they might call it. And so I put together a challenge which will help with that, which is more diet focused because it's not about doing endless abs, as you probably know. It's about focusing on your diet for that. So I put together that challenge, and it's the same thing I did and it's what other people are now doing. And then people wanted more and more stuff. So what I actually do now is I send out a free workout every single week, which would be super quick and effective to do. And have a for people that want even more, they want direct coaching from me. I call myself a virtual trainer because I'm not physically there in person, but I do my best to be as present as possible. So it's a private members area where people can download every single workout I've ever done. They get access to over 150 recipes, over 100 different workouts, demo videos. And then every week I check in with them and go through their diet, their questions, and help them to stay on track. Because that's the biggest thing is accountability for any program that you'll probably know from doing when you did bodybuilding. It's you need to report into someone to keep you on track. So I have that service as well as I do live workouts so they can actually work out with me at the same time. And I basically do what I did exactly before at the gym, but just through my computer.
I see. Yeah, that's really cool. I'm curious to like hear more about your experience of like the marketing and entrepreneurship and like website. Like, excuse me, one sec. I just need to cough.
Yes.
I mean, you've had by building that online business as you've done, you've had a lot of experience with like the internet marketing side of things. And give us what like tell us more about that. Like, what's the do's and don'ts, and what stuff would you do again? What wouldn't you do again? You know, what works, what doesn't work, that kind of thing.
I think it was a very eye-opening period because from going from the gym, which was very much word of mouth, and you've got a physical presence, haven't you? Whereas on the internet, you've got to compete with so many people, and a lot of them have very high budgets. And I, because I kind of fell into it accidentally, I just put information out there, and if people saw it, people saw it. But then it got to a stage where, okay, I want people to see it now. And so I tried a few things myself. And I was just going round and round in circles. And it was mainly with getting ads approved because of the industry, weight loss and fitness. They are quite regimented with what's allowed and what's not allowed. And if you don't study that kind of stuff, it's hard to get things approved. And most people don't have time to study that kind of thing. And so I hired someone to do it for me. And initially, that took away all the pain that I was dealing with, which I felt I was so stressed by.
So you're describing Facebook ads, right?
Facebook hasn't any ads actually in weight loss. I was just getting everything was just being disapproved, including Google as well. And I couldn't work out why. And it was I wanted to get on with creating programs and not worry about how the ads are performing. And so I hired someone to do that, and that was a big weight off my shoulders. And then I just jumped in 2 feet first and head first. And I think my biggest mistake was just when you are so sick to death of doing something on your own and you allow someone else to do it, and then you kind of just run with whatever they say because you're like, yeah, whatever, this is what you do, this is what you do. But actually, you still need to check everything is right for you. And that was something I didn't do initially because it was such a, it was almost like a relief to have someone just do it. And I ended up with so many softwares that I thought I needed. A software for this, a software for that, and I just think it was just too much, and it was so complicated, and I just didn't know. I don't like not knowing what's going on, and so I think my biggest do is just it doesn't matter how big you grow, just try and keep it as simple as possible. You help me with that, just keeping it super simple, and basically that's what I did. I just cancelled everything, moved, which was hard to do because you've got so much invested in that. You've got everything set up, you've got all your emails going out from one place. To have to change it, it's just like it's so much easier to stick with it all and just be like, I'm confused by it, but I'm going to stick with it because it's going to be a lot of hard work to change it. But keeping it simple, just by making that change, again, it was like a weight was lifted off my shoulders.
Yeah,
and
I think
a financial burden.
That's a really important. I think this is really important for anything, because it. I realized a long time ago, because my life was more complicated sort of several years ago. I had sort of several different company structures and stuff, and like a lot of legal paperwork going on. And it really occurred to me that being able to sleep at night and go to sleep peacefully with nothing on your mind bothering you, stressing you, like really that. Like if you don't have that, something's not right, is it? And delegating can be a good thing, but it's not always the right thing. You know, you can end up giving other people stuff to do, but then you kind of lose touch of what's going on. You lose the pulse of what's going on in your business and stuff, don't you? And like in some ways, there is a lot of stuff is better just to do it yourself, so that you understand it, so that you know what's going on. Because I think you and me had a similar experience with that. Like you spend, even though you've delegated stuff, you spend a lot of time like checking what they've done and making sure you're happy with it. And I had a similar thing with the marketing company I already mentioned. You know, I was paying these people to manage my marketing, but I was spending the same amount of time like checking, because I wasn't sure what they were doing. So I'm watching everything they do, checking the results, and in the end I decided I might as well just do it myself. You know, I'm paying them, and you know, it's a fine line, isn't it, what to delegate and what not to.
Yeah, and I think it also depends what your business is as well. So there's loads of membership sites available now online for fitness, but the difference is with mine is it is me. Like I am the brand, so it's not like you're going to get lots of different instructors, or it doesn't matter who sends a message. Like all the message needs to be in my voice. And when you hire someone else, that voice changes. And when I went look back at some of the emails that have been sent out, I thought that is not what I would say or how I would even say it. And anyone that's been following you for a little while will know that. And so that can put people off. And it's like what you said, when you go to bed, if you don't feel good. I mean, I was stressed to open my inbox because there was just so much going on. It was just far too corporate, almost too big brand, too unpersonalized, and that is exactly not what I wanted.
And I think for people like us that are kind of sort of solopreneur kind of people, your business model has to fit with your lifestyle and stuff, doesn't it? And that's why everybody's business model is going to be different. Like the stuff that I do, you know, like with my handstand workshops or whatever, is suited to me and my lifestyle and who I am, and then the stuff that you do will be tailored to your lifestyle, and that's why, you know, everybody's business is important. It has to be compatible with your lifestyle, doesn't it? I think it's really cool that you pushed the boundaries and you found out what was too much and too complicated, and then you've reined it back in a bit now, I think.
Yeah, I think sometimes you have to lose your way to know which way you want to go. And that's exactly what I didn't actually realise that I'd got lost a little bit until, I'm not even sure what happened, it made me realise. I think it was just the amount of stress that was building up. And I remember thinking, I was quite stressed with the gym because it was just a lot of work, not because it was complicated, it's just a lot of work. And I've changed things so I can be a mum how I want to be a mum. And now I feel like I'm trying to juggle stuff, and I don't want to juggle her. She comes first. And I think that just made me look into it and be like, this is not what I intended it to be.
Mm. And in terms of the elements of your business, like what do you enjoy doing most in terms of the thing that, you know, if you could go back and start it again, what's the best bits that you would do from scratch?
I think, you know, the best bits that I do are stuff that I get to continually do, and that's constantly create new programs, different programs, different workouts, seeing people do them, seeing them enjoying them, seeing them get results, them telling me about the results and enjoying what they're doing. I think a lot of it is people don't really enjoy, not everyone, but a lot of people don't enjoy working out. And then when you find a way of making it a bit more fun, or for some reason it works for them, then I love hearing about that. If they say they never used to work out before, now they work out every day and they've caught the fitness bug, that's what I enjoy the most, and that's where I like to spend my time. I don't like doing all the other bits. I know you have to do it, but I prefer just let me be the trainer.
Also, just changing topics slightly, in terms of parenthood, What I wanted to say is, I mean, what I'm trying to say, it's really cool that you created a business that fits around, being a mother, doesn't it? And you've put your daughter first, really. I mean, tell us about some of your decision making in terms of how you've chosen to, to do that in terms of your lifestyle based around your daughter.
I think it stems from how my mum was with me and my brother. She was always there, 100% all the time. And we didn't go to nursery, not that I remember, but when we did go to school, she always picked us up, she always dropped us off, she always took us to after school clubs, she always cooked all our meals. And those things are quite important to me, and I want to replicate the same. So if I was still at the gym or still had work that was like that and not tailored around Imani, I would miss out on those things because, the world is changing where you can't always have a parent stay at home without an income. I still need an income. My husband still needs to work. So it was either change the way I did things or miss out. And I just couldn't, I didn't want that. And she's not that it made a difference if she was a boy, but she's my little girl. And I want to, you feel very protective. And I'm very protective of her. And I want to be the person that she wants to be with. I don't want that. My biggest fear is her wanting to be with someone else that isn't me. And so I wanted to make sure that I could do all those things and cook all her meals and take her to all the classes that she likes and to see them because they grow up. Everyone says it, but you don't realize it until you see it yourself. They grow up so fast. I've got photos on my phone from a few weeks ago that I haven't posted. And when I go to post, I think she doesn't even look like her anymore because she's changed so much in such a short period of time. I just don't want to miss a thing. And that's why I changed everything that I did to suit her.
Yeah, I think that's really great. And I think I was raised in the same way. Like my mum was a mum, like my mum was there for us, she'd pick us up, take us to school. She was, and I really don't like it. Kind of, some people have got really, attitudes have changed in a direction that I don't like around that kind of thing. I mean, there's some people that think, it's great to have kids and then go back to work as soon as you can and put them with a babysitter and stick them in daycare and like stick them with a childminder or whatever. And that's a really horrible, and I don't like that. I mean, I'm just speaking for myself, you can tell me what you think, but I think mums being mums, I think it's terrible the way that some people, not everyone, but some people kind of frown upon it, and that, it gets into the kind of feminism stuff that I think is really ugly. But anyway, I'll stop there without going too far. But yeah, I mean, if you want to say anything, go ahead on that.
I think, parenthood, motherhood is such a, you literally can't do right. There is always someone that's going to, dish your opinion on whatever you're doing. If you're a stay-at-home mum, you should be working, you should be providing. If you go to work, you should be with your child. You literally, honestly, the amount of stuff you post and someone, the first thing someone will comment on is, oh, your strap's not right on the car seat. You just think, oh, get a grip. You know what? Everyone's got an opinion on it. And I just think you can't, it's difficult to say, I get what you're saying. I think it's difficult because you don't know everybody's circumstances. That could have been me if I hadn't changed stuff around. But not everyone knows there's an option to do that. Some people are so stuck in there, I've got a job, I must go to work, I've been worked there for years, that they don't realise that there may be another way to do it. And also, it is actually is very it's easy to go to work than it is to look after your daughter all day long or your child because they are really testing. And if you don't get a break, it can be quite difficult at times. But I think everyone's circumstances are so different that it's difficult to say. Because I've got friends that you could easily say they had their baby at 6 weeks, they're in nursery, but they had to go back to work. They had no choice. They felt they had no choice but to go back to work. And to look at an alternative option may have meant a good year in a drop of earnings, which they may not have been able to afford to pay the house. I know parents like this, but and it's not a case that they want to go to work. It's just that they feel that that is their only choice. I think choices aren't necessarily opened up to what you can do. And I do actually think from stuff with the gym, the stuff that I went through on maternity leave, that you can feel quite stuck. It's because when the gym closed and reopened as a CrossFit box, I then wasn't receiving any maternity pay. And so then you become quite, okay, now I have zero income just like that, and I'm a mum and I need to look after her. Even if I wanted to take her to nursery, that's even more money. And so it can be very, very, you can feel very, very stuck, but I think it's everybody's responsibility to find a way out of it.
Something that I noticed when I was first doing my internet marketing stuff years ago.
Sorry, Ben, the line's gone very crackly.
Oh, right. One sec. Yeah, my mic goes funny sometimes. One sec.
It's better now.
Is it better? Okay.
Yeah.
One thing I noticed when I was first doing my internet marketing stuff and my online guitar lesson stuff, and you can get quite, being self-employed, you can get quite isolated if you're not careful. And of course, it depends on your circumstances. It depends on, your social lifestyle and all that kind of thing. But for me, I got quite isolated, and it kind of creeps up on you. And I kind of got to a point where I was just sat on my laptop in my house, and I eventually realized I didn't have much social life and I didn't have many friends, and I'd sort of put all my attention into, internet stuff. And I mean, after that point, I kind of corrected it and I did the opposite. I got involved with as much stuff as I possibly could, and I kind of swung the other way. So I guess, like, what's your experience with that? Have you experienced that?
I get that completely. And if it wasn't for the fact that fitness isn't just what I do, but also what I, it's not just work, but it's also what I enjoy doing, I would find the same thing. Because although most of my workouts that I do are at home, I make myself go to the gym literally to socialize. Because otherwise, I wouldn't see anyone. I'm at home, I have a money, I'm working, I'm doing workouts, I'm speaking to people online all day, but I'm not physically seeing anyone. And you're right, you can start feeling very alone, and sometimes you need an adult, as a mother, an adult conversation. So yeah, I make sure that I do get out. And actually, when I take her to her classes and stuff that she goes to, they are often geared for, even though it's for your little ones, it is often taken into consideration that for the mums to network and to speak about things and to rant or whatever they want to do. So it's actually quite nice going to those things as well.
Are you the kind of person that, like, has always got kind of like long-term, mid-term goals and projects ahead, or are you more like sort of go with the flow, take it as it comes, see how you feel, like, in more in the moment kind of thing?
No, I set goals, but at the same time, if something pops up, I kind of just go with it, and because you never know where it's going to lead to. But I do definitely have goals. Like next year, I'm going to compete. That's my goal. I want to double the amount of mums that I've helped. That's another goal. So I definitely set goals. And then anything else that comes in, if I get an opportunity to come to me, unless it's fitness related, I tend not to look at it because I don't want to get distracted. But if there's something within that fits in with my work that comes up, then I will just go with the flow with it and see where it leads me to.
Is there, besides like Mum Warrior and your fitness stuff, is there any other particular product projects, or like, is there anything else you're up to besides those things? I guess being a mum is like full time anyway, isn't it? So.
Yeah, that keeps me pretty busy. But I don't know how I actually got it, but years ago when I used to work as a dancer, I used to apply for everything, anything, TV, reality, anything. And I think when you've done it for so long, they keep the details in the database, don't they? And every now and again, I'll get contacted for something. I won't even know what it is, and I'll just be like, yeah, okay, you can do an interview with it. And recently, I got a call about a program about food, so I was just like, okay, yeah. And then they interviewed my whole family, and just kind of, it's a BBC program, and we've been shortlisted, but we don't know where we are at the minute or when it's going to come out. But that's kind of something I'm just going with the flow with. It's not really a project, I'm just seeing where it leads to.
Yeah, cool. And just quickly, just mention Okium's music. Like, yeah, just tell us quickly about what he does.
So he is a very talented pianist. He used to play with lots of different celebrities as a pop keyboardist. Now he does his own music, and he tours a what he calls cinematic classical type music, where he writes and composes, and he tours all around the world doing that. In fact, he actually played, not his own music, but he played in the back of the Mission Impossible film. He's in one of the scenes, which is really random.
Oh wow, cool, that's great. I want to ask you a question that I feel is a little bit cheesy, but it's kind of a cool question. If you could go back to your younger self, teenage self, what advice would you give yourself? That's a bit of an open question, that, isn't it?
I would say don't let a timeline stress you out, because I think I've been wrapped up so many times in I have to buy a house because I'm in my 30s, or I have to have a baby now because I'm approaching 30, or I have to do this. And I've spent so much time worrying about it fitting in with everyone else's timelines, when it actually doesn't, it doesn't matter. You can have a child in your 40s if you want to. You can buy a house whenever if you want to. You can start a new business at any stage. And I think I spent a lot of time actually worrying about trying to get stuff done in my 20s, and then when it doesn't happen, feeling like I've missed out or failed. And I didn't do both. Everything happens at the right time.
Yeah, that's great that. Yeah, the sense of needing to live up to other people's kind of expectations is that's a killer that, isn't it? That's a real tough one. When you're living your life based on trying to, please other people, or even if you just perceive it or that way in your mind, that really, yeah, that's a big one that, isn't it? Yeah, it is. I'm still learning that, and that I have still not learned that. So that's an ongoing project, isn't it? That one. It's kind of easier said than done, isn't it? Like learning to be yourself and learning how to live life in the way that, where you can be yourself. That's really
Yeah, I think it's,
fundamental, isn't it?
yeah, it's always going to be an ongoing, but as long as you're aware of it, a lot of people aren't aware of it, and are forever, comparing themselves to other people that have done this at this age and that at that age, and
Yeah, I
just
mean,
forget about ages.
I won't keep you on the line much longer because we've been going a while. But I mean, like recently, I've been going through a bit of a process where basically, I'm very ambitious and very capitalistic and very business minded, and I've always wanted to be rich and that kind of thing. And I spent so much time around kind of like, anti-capitalist people in the last 5 years, without meaning to, just in general alternative hippie yoga circles. And I was really drawn to the kind of the yoga world just because of the health and the well-being, and and then I got to a point just where I realized I wasn't able to be myself. I love I've always admired business people, successful people. I love watching videos about, money and wealth creation. That's what excites me. That's what turns me on. And then just recently I realized I wasn't able to be myself around these people. They're kind of the opposite. They got a very different set of values. And so I'm going through the process at the moment of just changing the circles that I'm in, and trying to be around people where I can, they're more sort of business minded, and like, and where I can sort of be myself more around that.
Yeah, you need that, because it's so important, the people that you spend your time around, isn't it? They rub off on you more than you think, even though you might not have the same values or opinions. With the fact that you're spending so much time with them, they can kind of rub off on you.
Yeah, and for me, like the kind of conversations where you're constantly having to justify, like, oh, why do you want to do that? Why is it you want to be successful? Does that mean you're not happy? Or why do you want money for it? It's like, oh my God, shoot me now. I can't do this no more, So, that's my personal journey, what I'm sort of processing at the moment. But I'm just about to move to a new city, and I've already got some plans of collaborating with. I've got some friends over there that are doing a lot of property stuff, and I'm going to get involved with them somehow. And I think hopefully that'll send me in a better direction that'll be sort of better for me.
Yeah, I think so, for sure. New place, new beginnings, new fresh start.
So, just so we can wrap up, tell people. I know you mentioned your websites and stuff, but how can people find you again?
If you want to connect with me on Instagram, it's at Memoria Official, or on Facebook, it's at Memoria. Everything's Memoria. Website is memoria.com as well.
Okay, Martine, thanks for your time. I'll leave you there, and I'll put this online. I'll send you the links when it's up.
Cool. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Bye for now.
Bye.